Hello, welcome to Pub Date with an Author. I'm Susan Pena, your host for today, and I will be talking with John Kissinger, who is the author of Inclement Angel and Angel Provocateur, both part of a series of speculative fiction. John Kissinger was born in California and grew up here in Berks County. His father was a teacher and music instructor, and his mother was a nurse. His family were Seventh-day Adventists. After graduating from the Blue Mountain Academy in Hamburg, he earned his bachelor's degree in theology at Southern Missionary College near Chattanooga, Tennessee, and his graduate degree in library science at Kutztown University. He has been a teacher, a bookstore manager, and a librarian. He spent 26 years as a reference librarian at Alvernia College and was adjunct instructor and then director of information technology. For 5 years, he was library director for Kettering College and Kettering Medical Center in Dayton, Ohio. After retiring, he began writing novels, resulting in the Lo Grare series of speculative fiction, including Sanguinary Angel, Revenant Angel, and his latest, a revised version of Inclement Angel and the new Angel Provocateur. These last two involve two main protagonists, Cheyenne Grigsby and Detective Wayne Hoyer, who are in a May-December relationship and who are trying to solve several mysteries and fight some mysterious extraterrestrials. And so, John Kissinger, welcome to Pub Date with an Author. I'm so happy to have you here.
Thank you, Susan.
Yeah.
Did I do all that?
You did all that. Wow. I know, isn't that amazing?
Right.
You need at least two lives to do all that stuff. So, I was hoping to have you read a little bit of your latest book, and just, you know, to give us a flavor of what the book is like. And I'd also like you to set it up a little bit, just tell us a little bit about the series and the books.
Okay.
Just
all right.
So people know.
And the series is set in the area near Chattanooga, Tennessee.
Mm-hmm.
And when I went to college there, I fell in love with the land and the people, and I just, when I started writing stories, it just seemed like a natural place to put the narratives. Mm-hmm. Cheyenne is one of the main characters, and she is one of the more challenging characters for me as an author, because I've never been a 17-year-old young woman,
mm-hmm.
and so I've had to learn that from the ground up. And in this particular book, which is the introduction to Angel Provocateur, Cheyenne is basically introducing herself to the reader and is laying the groundwork for the relationship between her and Wayne and getting the story going.
Mm-hmm.
So we will just go on to there. And there I am. All right. Hi, I'm Cheyenne. Cheyenne Mariah Grigsby of Soddy Daisy, Tennessee, to be formal. I'm 17. I'll be a high school senior this fall and captain of the cheer squad. 5'5", 110 pounds in a trim body. My long hair is very blonde and my skin is like a permanent suntan. I have my biological parents to thank for that combo. I fell in love with Wayne at first sight. I don't rightly know how it works, but I know now it really happens. Back in April, I was minding my own business one Sunday afternoon, washing dishes and humming an Eva Cassidy song, when I looked out the window and saw Wayne walking up our driveway. In that moment, my world changed. My heart will always beat for him. Near as I can tell, he likes me too. Sure, it took him a while. Wasn't love at first sight for him. You know what they say, we girls mature faster than guys, and I reckon that's as true in love as it is in life. Wayne is older than me, a lot older. Oh, it's not as bad as Richard Burton to Tatum O'Neill in Circle of Two, but still, Wayne is 37. He remembers the world before 9/11, before Spice Girls. The 20-year age gap is often the rough part of our road together. Sometimes we have misunderstandings and fights simply because we see things so differently. It's like living out parts of Middlemarch, one day at a time. Theoretically, one of us is more mature and less prone to errors in judgment than the other. Personally, I think that's me. People assume the mature role goes to Wayne, and I'm willing to let everyone, including him, think that it helps keep the peace.
Thank you. Sure. So what inspired you to write this series in the first place? And then specifically, why did you choose to focus on this relationship in these last couple of books?
The series started with Wayne as the only protagonist. Mm-hmm. And I was always interested in the Raymond Chandler novels about the hard-boiled detective, mm-hmm. and film noir movies. And I wanted to write a character who had that kind of approach to solving crimes, mm-hmm. but at the same time had his own particular weaknesses and challenges that he had to overcome. Mm-hmm. And so I started writing a story, and I really had not read much in the way of mysteries at the time, so I had to learn that genre from the ground up. And as I was writing Wayne's story and producing the storylines that would eventually meet in later books in the series, there was a minor walk-on, walk-off character her name was Hesper. And as I was writing, I write with music CDs playing in the background, especially CDs I've never heard before as background. And one day, I'm writing a scene, and there's a line in the song that, and I thought, that's something that she should say, whatever the line was. And once I started focusing in and started finding more and more things for her to say, I realized that this was becoming more than a minor character. Mm-hmm. And I've always been a big fan of strong female characters in films and in books. And I was waiting for my chance to write that particular kind of character. And Cheyenne was basically in the songs I was listening to saying, here I am, here I am. Mm-hmm. And so I started making up her character and her background and her plot lines based on the songs that I was listening to. And it became evident that this was only going to work well if she had a close relationship with Wayne so that their storylines could mesh and complement each other. Hmm. And so some of the information about her is accidental in the sense that it comes from songs. For instance, she's only 17 because that's what the Beatles said in I Saw Her Standing There.
Right.
And Mandy Moore has a song called 17. And so I thought, okay, well, that's a good age for her. But then as soon as she becomes 17, that creates a series of challenges and problems that I then need to overcome, one of which is Wayne's 37. Mm-hmm. She's 17, the 20-year age gap, and age gaps are not as rare as some people seem to think they are. Some of my early readers objected to the age gap, but there's a whole community of people out there on the web who have age gap relationships. And to me, that just became an interesting challenge.
Yeah.
She has a background that I decided that she was going to be, in some sense, Romani or Gypsy in her ethnic background. But she also has to have long blonde hair because of another song. And so I figured out a way that could happen. Mm-hmm. And so as she gradually began to develop, she started taking over some of the storylines and some mm-hmm. of the investigations, And it just became really fun to write her into the story.
Mm-hmm. What did you learn about this sort of relationship as you were writing about it? It sounds like you did some research into how that works for
yes.
people. And
yes.
so what did you come away with?
I came away with the idea that even though it sounds like trouble, and in a lot of cases, it is trouble, mm-hmm. it is basically a series of challenges and conflicts that the two characters have to deal with, and that's gold for a fiction writer, mm-hmm. to have conflicts and challenges that the character needs to overcome.
Mm-hmm.
And so we overcome them different ways. For instance, in Tennessee, the age of consent is 18.
Mm-hmm.
So they have agreed that there's no sex until she turns 18.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, no one believes them.
Right.
But you know, that's so. But, yeah. you know, that's their point of view. And then that makes August 1st, which is her birthday, mm-hmm. a target that is continually getting closer and closer.
Mm-hmm.
So I learned that there were times when, for instance, love at first sight, mm-hmm. that's a challenge in and of itself.
Yeah.
And some of my early readers said, well, no, that can't happen. That's not possible. So we started doing research on that. And at the time, I was working at Kettering College, and I brought in about 30 or 35 students, one at a time, to interview, because they're Cheyenne's age.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And they got a questionnaire that said, do you believe love at first sight is possible? And if it was yes or no, we then had a series of questions beyond that. And they weren't going to change my mind, but I needed to hear as many different objections to love at first sight as possible, mm-hmm. so we could take care of them in the story.
Right.
The best one was, there was a young lady, her family was from Bangladesh, and she initially said no, she doesn't believe it's possible, and we're going through the other questions, and she frowns and she says, you know, my parents had an arranged marriage. That's kind of institutionalized love at first sight. She says, I'm going to change my answer. So it is
yeah.
possible.
That's one way to look at it.
One way, yeah. right. And I think what comes out of this is that there are so many ways to look at this multifaceted situation that I don't expect to run out of material for the next 12 books or so.
Probably not, yeah. So who were some of the writers that you enjoyed reading when you were a child and a teen? What got you into writing?
I can remember, first of all, and my grandmother was a very avid reader. And she when I was little, she would read to me when I was falling asleep, and mm-hmm. She would call you up, and because she had found something in the New Yorker that she wanted to read to somebody, and so she'd read it to whoever answered the phone. And but the first writer that I remember is Edgar Rice Burroughs, who mm-hmm. wrote the Tarzan series,
yeah.
and then the John
yeah.
Carter series and so on, mm-hmm. because of the way that he told the stories.
Mm-hmm.
I had a friend who said that for him, Burroughs' books, the page disappeared and all he saw was the story.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that would be something I would like to do. So I remember reading Burroughs, I remember reading science fiction authors like Isaac Asimov, and I read Raymond Chandler mm-hmm. and his Philip Marlowe books, and those kinds of books. I've discovered also that sometimes an author would write a book which I thought was really great. Rachel Maddox wrote a book called The Green Kingdom, which I reread every couple years. Her other books just leave me disinterested.
Mm-hmm.
So it, sometimes it's not just the author, it's the author and this particular book that sparks the kind of interest in which I come away from that thinking, mm-hmm. I would like to do that.
Yeah.
I also tell the story, when I was 13, there was a TV show called The Patty Duke Show. And Patty played a teenager in New York City, And she hears about a French teenager who writes a novel. So she wants to write a novel. And her parents set her up in the attic with a typewriter, and her mother brings her milk and cookies and so on while she's up there writing page after page about Prince Igor and Princess Natasha and so on. And one day, Patty's mother comes up the stairs, and Patty's up there weeping her eyes out. And the mother says, "Well, Patty, what's wrong?" And Patty says, "Prince Igor just died." Now, she's talking about a scene that she just wrote. And as I was sitting there watching that, I thought, that's what I want to do someday. I want to write a scene that is so poignant that it makes me cry right after I wrote it. That was my aim.
Okay.
So I'm still working
on it. Did you write much, you know, like when did you start to actually write?
I started writing when I was in the sixth grade.
Okay.
And what is now called fan fiction. Uh-huh. I was writing fan fiction against the Edgar Rice Burroughs novels and science fiction novels and so on. And I continued that writing right on through my teenage years and so on. Mm-hmm. I put all the writing aside when my first daughter was born, because I wanted to make sure that I was concentrating on doing that. Mm-hmm. That was an important thing. But once daughter number three turned about 18 or so, I decided it was time to dust off the manuscripts and get writing again.
Yeah.
And haven't stopped since.
Yeah. Do you write every day?
Every day.
Every day.
Every day.
That's great.
If not actual dialogue or narrative, at least making notes for trying to figure out what's coming next.
Mm-hmm. And it sounds like you do a lot of research.
I'm a librarian.
Of course.
I cannot not do research.
Right.
So,
So that would be, you know, a lot of the fun of writing, a novel or something, you know,
yes.
To get to do all that research.
And you learn about all kinds of things that you never knew before, which is the point of research.
Yeah.
And because the novels, there's a meme somewhere that says, "Pay no attention to my email. I am not a serial killer. I'm an author."
Mm-hmm.
We're researching everything that we need to talk about.
Sure. Yeah, you have to know these things. Can you highlight one of the most interesting things that you learned about in the course of writing any of your books?
I think that while I'm thinking of that, one of the more interesting aspects of the challenges of these books is that they have to be, at least in part, narrated by Cheyenne.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a friend at Alvernia, and she and I disagreed about just about everything, but we were still friends.
Mm-hmm.
And she insisted that a man could not really write fiction from a woman's point of view, that it was easy for a woman to write from a man's point of view, but not vice versa.
Yeah, it's an odd thing to say.
Well, yeah, and she had some points in her favor.
Yeah.
And one of my great regrets is that she's now gone, and I would love to put these into her hands and say, tell me where I went wrong.
Uh-huh, right.
It's pretty convincing,
really.
And I love readers, early readers especially, who would read something, a Cheyenne chapter, and they would say, "John, a woman would never say it like this. You need to rewrite that," because that's what you learn. You learn that, for instance, women have a much better sense of smell than men do, which means that when Cheyenne's narrating a scene, I can't just pay attention to the visual details. I have to pay attention to the aromas.
Yeah.
I have to pay attention, and women are very sensual in the sense of it's not just what they see, it's what they hear, what they smell, what they taste, and so on. And so I have to train myself to see the world from that point of view when I'm writing her chapters. And then I give it to one of my readers and hold my breath and hope that I got it right this time.
Right. Tell us about your mom's diary.
So,
you have
I have it here.
If
it says 1946, and One of the great resources for me to learn how to narrate like Cheyenne is to see the world from a woman's point of view. And the closer that woman is to Cheyenne's age, the better, because she doesn't have a lot of things clouding her perception. And I just love having Cheyenne consultants who I can go and I say, I have a Cheyenne question. What are the first three things that you notice about a guy? Mm-hmm. And then I make a list so that when Cheyenne's describing a guy, I'm describing the way that she would see him, not the way that I would see him. And I'm blessed by having my mom's diaries from the time that she was Cheyenne's age. So I'm seeing the world from her point of view. She never expected anybody to read this except mm-hmm. for her. Mm-hmm. And it's invaluable to be able to see the world from her point of view and then to translate that into that's the way that Cheyenne would see the world.
Right.
In one way or another.
And it's interesting on so many levels to get into your mother's perspective and thought process and all
yeah,
that.
Yeah, and her life. But it's part of an ongoing, I have a recently acquired Cheyenne consultant. Her name is Sage. And she's around Cheyenne's age, and mm-hmm. she was a cheerleader, mm-hmm. so even better. And so I asked her to write down some of her thoughts for what it was like being a cheerleader in high school and mm-hmm. so on. And one of the things that she wrote was that we were very concerned with what we looked like in our cheerleader outfits, mm-hmm. and did my hip dips show? Mm-hmm. And I stopped and I reread that. Because I had no idea what she was talking about. So I started asking around, said, have you ever heard the term hip dips? And it turns out that anyone who's over the age of about 23 probably won't recognize the term.
Right.
Basically it is, you know, you have a woman's hips that are shaped kind of bow like that, and where the leg comes up to meet the pelvis, there's a gap there. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times muscle won't fill in that gap, mm-hmm. so that there's a little indent in their hips. That's a hip dip.
Yeah.
And hip dips turn out to be something like short hair, curly hair, or straight hair, curly hair. The ones who have them don't want them, and the ones who don't have them want them.
Right.
Well, I never would have known. Now I'll be able to toss out hip dips in a line somewhere,
there you go.
And it makes it sound like I know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
It's great.
Yeah.
Thank you, Sage.
So, so we have about 5 minutes left.
Okay.
So tell me, you're working on another book?
I'm working on the next book in the series.
Okay.
And
you had a cover for that?
Yes.
So, yeah, let's see it. Sure. Okay. Am I holding this up in the right? Yeah. Beautiful. Cover. Here is Cheyenne right there with her guitar, and there's someone lurking in the trees.
Yes. The other thing I've learned from hiring models uh-huh. for covers and uh-huh. for other material is that if you tell a model what the scene is like, she then acts out the scene mm-hmm. and she adds things to it. Mm-hmm. That is so great.
It is
because I can look at pictures and learn things that I didn't know when we first started the photo shoot.
Right.
And that's another aspect in which Johnny can be taught.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
that's right. So do you have a name for the next one?
I am experimenting with, it's either going to be called Send an Angel, uh-huh. which was a previous book, which now has been completely replaced. But I'm tempted to, I discovered along the way that amnesia is an ancient Greek word that means forgiveness. And uh-huh. this particular novel is going to involve a lot of forgiveness.
Okay.
And I thought maybe amnesia angel.
Or amnesiac angel.
Or amnesiac angel.
How about that?
Angel amnesiac. So, you know, I'm looking for that. But the book is also, Cheyenne begins her senior high school year.
Wow.
During this book.
Yeah.
August 1st comes during this book. So there's a lot of,
okay.
Yeah,
so
a lot of challenges.
There's going to be some interesting scenes.
Interesting
up,
scenes,
right?
Yes.
Yeah,
yes.
And she's had a really full life, you know, in that year between her junior
right.
year and her senior year.
The other thing I'd like to mention is that in Inclement Angel, there are a series of letters between Wayne and his ex-wife mm-hmm. when they're actually breaking up.
Mm-hmm.
And a author that I met named Caitlin Callahan wrote Annie's letters mm-hmm. completely.
Mm-hmm.
And I wanted a woman's viewpoint and mm-hmm. and they turned out so great.
Yeah.
And
yeah, they did.
I couldn't have
yeah.
written them as well as she did.
Oh, that's great. So. Well, it sounds like you are so immersed in this and it's so wonderful.
My family complains about it all the time.
I'll bet, yeah.
Yes.
But I totally get it. I'm so glad that there are people who are doing that.
And Cheyenne's like one of the family.
Yes.
She sits down with us at
right.
dinners and,
yeah,
and
she
all
is.
That.
She's a very real presence.
Yeah.
So. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
For sharing. Where can people get your books?
On Amazon's the easiest place.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And they're all available on Amazon, both as paperback, hardcover print, and as Kindles.
Okay.
As ebooks.
And how many books are in your series?
Right now, there are three viable ones. There will be four
okay.
soon because I'm revising the very first one.
Okay.
And so then the next one, whatever we call that, will be the fifth.
Yeah.
In that
yeah.
series.
So.
Seven more to go.
Okay. So this is going to be like sort of like Proust, you know, you're going to have
right, right, yeah, and it's a race, you know, can I live long enough
yeah,
to finish the series?
Right, right, well, hopefully you will, and it's been so good to talk to you.
Oh, it's been good talking to you, thank
and
you.
Please stay in touch with us.
Will do.
And let us know
will
when
do.
Your new book comes out.
All right.
All right, thank you so much.
Thank you.
For watching Pub Date with an Author. And we will be showing this at some point in the future, and it will be archived on YouTube.
Cool.
Thank you.